Cummings Burley, and I'm the director for the Center for Safe and Secure Schools. I'm excited about this opportunity to meet you and greet you today on behalf of our superintendent, James Colbert. And he's just come on board and he's recommitted to establishing the center as a viable resource to you and the districts that we serve. So today is an important meeting and I'm so happy that you're here. I want you to meet a couple of the staff members that we have. One of the things that he did to commit to building this back up is to give us some personnel units. And I'm really fortunate to have two outstanding school safety specialists, and I want to introduce them to you so that you can know them. You'll be hearing from them from time to time. They'll be talking to you about your needs. I'd like to first of all introduce Cherie Kruger. She's our safety program specialist. Also, Cherie's background is military. She worked for 10 years in the military and worked in security and worked a lot of emergency preparation. She's done some work here with the court system, helping kids and their parents who are experiencing some problems. Also, you probably know him. He probably doesn't need introduction, but I'll introduce him anyway. Steve Cathey. Steve is a law enforcement veteran of 30 years. He's also had a lot of experience with emergency preparedness and emergency management through TransStar. He was the liaison for the Harris County Sheriff's Office here. We're fortunate to have him. He's our lead auditor on the safety audits. He also will be facilitating this meeting going forward. So that's my staff. We'll have administrative support coming on board. Julie Carson is outside, kind of helping you guys get settled in. She's been helping in an administrative support role today. Your packets, if I could direct your attention to them, on the left-hand side of your packet, you'll see the agenda. Behind that is an evaluation of this meeting today, along with a needs assessment. That is very important for us. We sent it out through email, first of all, a few weeks, maybe about a week or so ago. We've got a few responses, but there are 26 schools that we serve in Harris County. So we need to hear from you. We're actively planning and trying to get the center set up in terms of training, but we want that training to be focused to your needs. First on our agenda today, we are very fortunate to have with us from the Mayor's Office of Homeland Security and Emergency Management, Jackie Miller. Jackie talked to me a little bit earlier in the year when I first came on the board about her school ready program and asked for an opportunity to come before you to talk about that. So Jackie, we welcome you. So would you come on up and talk to us about your school ready program? Thank you so much.
Well, I want to talk to you a little bit this morning about the school ready program. Does anybody know about the school ready program? I'm seeing maybe a nod, a couple of nods. Okay. So for those of you that do know about the school ready program, this is just a reminder about what it is, but we do want to tell you a little bit about it. It is a resource that's available to your school district, and every year we kind of do some marketing and things to the schools to try to get this out there. And we, little by little, we're getting out there and talking more about what we can provide for your schools and your school districts. So I'm happy this morning to talk to you a little bit about the School Ready program, and I'm gonna just run through a couple slides real quick. You know the statistics. I mean, this is nothing new, but we're a large area, and the most important thing is that we can have all kinds of disasters that happen here. What just happened recently, floods is a huge one, where today is the first day of hurricane season. So you're gonna be hearing a lot about that over the next few months until when does it end?
November 30th.
November 30th. So and really our active months typically, there's nothing typical about anything really, but typically August and September are our more active months. But that doesn't mean that we sort of blow off June, July, and because it could happen any time. And as we saw with the recent floods, it doesn't even take a hurricane to cause a disaster here and a disaster declaration and a lot of damage. So well, we've got to continue to talk about preparedness and the importance of, it just seems like we get people's attention during hurricane season. But honestly, preparedness is a year-round thing. And what we really want is that culture of preparedness where people are just doing it naturally. You know, it took years and years for the seatbelt thing to take off, and now what do? We just automatically put on our seatbelts. Our kids, they're probably better at it than we are because they've been doing it their whole lives and they didn't have to learn that skill like we did. We had to change our behavior. They're just sort of, it's just standard practice. Same thing with preparedness. We want it to be part of the culture. We want it to be a more resilient community, and certainly what we've seen, and we continue to talk about the advantages of our region, which is neighbors helping neighbors. We really do that well here, but we really need to continue to talk about the importance of doing that. When we're out and about and talking about preparedness to communities, of course, the most important thing is for you to be prepared as an individual and then your family. But we really encourage people to go to their workplaces and their schools to find out what is the preparedness plan, what is the disaster emergency plan for this school, for my workplace. And there's kind of two parts to that. It's what is the staff going to do, but then what is the community going to do to respond in the case of schools? What am I going to do if something happens and my kids are in school? People need to understand this, and that needs to be part of their plan that they're building for themselves and for their families. And what we talk to them about schools is that could change every year because they might change schools, they might move up into a middle school. So every year parents need to ask and understand what is the emergency plan for this school. And then your staff, you need to be training your staff all along, but we all need to kind of understand these things so as we're building our personal plans, we understand all the people that we're connected with and the organizations we're connected with, kind of what are those plans and how does my plan fit into their plans. So we really encourage folks to go beyond their individual plan and look at workplaces and schools and really get involved in their community, because in the neighbor helping neighbor is so important in any kind of these disasters. And so we really want to encourage people to get involved in their communities and to really start building those communities right now before something happens. You can do that even in your schools. As you're putting out newsletters, I know PTOs put out newsletters, you put out newsletters, you have websites, you can be putting preparedness messages. And all the messages that we put out, either through Harris County Emergency Management, City of Houston Emergency Management, or any of your emergency management offices across the region, you can use those same messages to put on your websites and newsletters to help us educate. You don't need to recreate a wheel. You just take those messages that we've all put out and distribute them to your families. This is really so important so that we're all talking preparedness and we're all talking what you need to do and the steps you need to take and where you find information. So help us communicate through all your newsletters. And then each year on May 1st, we have May Day Houston, which is a preparedness day to really talk preparedness messages, and you can help us encourage folks to get involved with that. One of the things I have handed you today is the DVD that we give out. It began with a 15-minute Are You Ready? Preparedness video that was created here in our region about how to make a plan, build a kit, and stay informed. We've added quite a bit to that video. It's now a 2-DVD set. So it has the Together Against the Weather hurricane readiness for persons or for children with functional and access needs. We've added the Ready Superheroes performance, which is what I'm going to talk to you about today. The Make the Call video, which is on suspicious behavior and IED awareness. And then the Run, Hide, Fight active shooter video, which is also on the DVD. On the left-hand side are all the English versions, and on the right-hand side, that DVD has all the alternate language versions. Just want to make a comment about Make the Call and Run, Hide, Fight. We have resources available, and some of this is in the material that I've given you, but and I've also given you a copy of this PowerPoint, so you can go and check out some of these things after the meeting. We also have a Neighborhood Ready program, which we can come out and do for neighborhoods. It's about a 90-minute program, but it really gets neighborhoods prepared to deal with the disaster. But one of the things we really figured out is that, you know, we need to start the children. They're a great advocate for helping us get their families prepared. If they go home and start talking about what we need to do to get prepared, because we really think that you should be including your children. Children should not be excluded from the process of being prepared. It is a family function. It's a family event. So children aren't scared, they're not afraid, because you're including them in the process of what are we gonna do if, and the more prepared they are, the less scared they're going to be, because they're gonna kinda know what's gonna happen in the case of an emergency. So we really encourage you to include the kids. And so we really started a K through five program a couple of years ago. We included the Ready Heroes. We came up with some curriculum, some of the curriculum you're already teaching at some of these levels. So it's really not new. It's very quick. It's very simple. And we're hoping that the schools will really take advantage of this resource and build it in. I know they need to meet certain standards in the state, and they've got lots they have to do. But there are times, particularly towards the end of the year, where they're looking to fill some time, a few minutes here and there, they could be talking about preparedness and delivering that message to kids, and we have resources to help you do that. This is our Ready Hero team. They are very popular when they're out in public. We have to have a management team with them so they're not pinched by adults and loved on by adults, and everyone loves a hero, right? That has muscles. I don't know. I don't get it, but they are a big deal when they're out and about, and they help us deliver an important message to the kids. But they really deliver the message of how to make a plan, build a kit, and stay in a fun way, so that because it doesn't have to be scary, but in a fun way, and they can come out and do the performance in your schools to really help you deliver that message. The packet I have given you, there's a packet that's in kind of a plastic wrap. It has a little bit about the curriculum, and all the curriculum is online at readyhoustontx.gov. So you can look further into all the materials and the sheets that they can use, and the how we sort of have given the teachers all the information they need to teach this curriculum. I've also given you kind of a one-page summary of the whole program, but we really ask you to take this curriculum. You can pick and choose what you want to do. It's by grade level. Of course, we think the most important things for K and one is that they know their name. They know their name, they know their address, they know their parents' names, they know some important information that they might need to have in an emergency if they were to get separated. And I know these are things that you're already teaching in the schools. The importance of having this information. So there's nothing new here, but it really sort of drives the message home of the importance of being prepared. Second and third goes to the sort of the next level, a little bit about what is a plan, what is a kit, and how to be informed, and really sort of takes it to that next level, because we think those kids really sort of begin to understand what each of those things are. And then fourth and fifth grade, we'd really like for them to get involved, where they could actually come up with a little curriculum to go into the other classes or to a school-wide assembly and teach something about preparedness. If you get those kids involved, where they're teaching the younger students, you really sort of connect with them, because you know they're the big kids of the school. They're the fourth and fifth graders that can help us teach, you know, the younger kids. So there's some ideas here about how you can teach those kids and do some research more about preparedness. There's lots of websites, lots of information, lots of things they can do. And maybe come up with a way that they could help us train the younger kids so that they can take that message home and do a great job of helping to educate their parents. Because we think that sometimes coming from the kids makes it a little more important at home, and we want them to have the message as well. We have developed a middle school program, which will be coming out soon. It's a very interactive program. We worked with the middle school teachers and counselors to get an idea about how to reach this age level of kids and what curriculum that we could use and how we could deliver the message within their schedule. So that's gonna be coming out in the fall, and it's gonna have a very interactive piece. We wanna really connect with this middle school. In high school, of course, we do the CERT program, and I'll talk more about that in a second. The readyhoustontx.gov has all of the resources that you need. We encourage you to go to your own emergency management office website. But what we find when we go to meetings that there are so many websites we name for you to go to get information that people sort of glass over and think, I've heard about the last www I want to hear, because you've now like named 10 that I need to go to for help. If you go to readyhoustontx.gov, that gets you to all the emergency management offices. It gets you to a lot of the other sites that get you information, FEMA, Red Cross. All of the videos are there. All the curriculum is there. Everything is there. We have not created new information here, but we want to give you some information and then get you to your emergency management office to really learn more about your specific jurisdiction. So we encourage you to go to the website, look around a little bit so you are familiar with some of the things that you can get to from this site. And then we also do CERT training. CERT training is out in the community. We're doing it all over the region. So you can go to even readyhoustontx.gov, go under training, and you can get to all the CERT coordinators that are within your jurisdiction to do training. Some schools have done this for their staff, so that their staff is more trained to deal with an emergency situation. So we could certainly do it for your staff. Any of the jurisdictions can do that for you. And then we do classes out in the community to get people trained. Team CERT is a little bit different. It is school-based, so rather than do a big community training with those teams that are underage, they're trained at the school level so that they could respond within the school setting. And so it's really great. We're trying to expand that in all the high schools across the region. But Team CERT is very popular. And then we have a couple of campuses that have done campus CERT. U of H, we've talked to Rice about doing campus CERT. So people are sort of taking that same, the same modules. We're training on site there so that their students and staff are prepared to deal with some kind of an emergency or disaster. We do that too. These are the basic things we always train on, and we don't. The only thing we don't do with K through five, we really don't talk to know your neighbor. Because kids at that level, that needs to come from your parents. What neighbors to go to, who's your contact person within the neighborhood. We're not really encouraging kids. That should be something that is done at your family and neighborhood level. But we talk about the other three steps with the K through five age groups: make a plan, build a kit, and stay informed. The hurricane workshop is coming up this Saturday at the George R. Brown. It is a regional event. It's a family event. All of the jurisdictions are involved in putting this on. Families can learn a lot about what's going on and how to get prepared and hear from the emergency managers, hear from the weathercasters, hear from National Weather Service and CenterPoint Energy. Electricity is a huge thing during these events. And so they can come down and learn about what they need to do in case of these emergencies. One of the things we all have to consider in our schools, in our workplaces, in our community, is that we have a lot of new folks that move here every year. We have people who have never been through these events. And if you think about the last time we've been through a hurricane, was Ike, which is a number of years ago. So we have a lot of new residents that have never been through a hurricane. We need to help them through some of the surveys and things we've done. A lot of people depend on their neighbors to tell them what's going to happen, or how do I prepare, or should I evacuate, or what should I know? Does it flood in our neighborhood? What do I need to do? So this neighbor helping neighbor thing is huge, and the more education we can get out there, the better prepared community we're going to have. And we certainly need to do that through the schools, starting with kindergartners all the way up through high school. It just needs to be part of what they do every day, is to think about how to be prepared. This is my contact information. One of the things I did not mention is this is a free resource. So if the Ready Heroes come to your school, ultimately we would like for you to have an assembly with all of your students. We did our first one the other day. We actually did, it was a big day. We did six performances in one day at one school. They pulled in grade level by grade level. We were there the entire day and educated each grade level on what they needed to do. We did a little education module before they performed, and it was a great way to sort of get that message out. So we're willing to work with you to see the best way to get the message across at any of your schools or school districts. What questions can I answer for you? That's kind of a quick overview, but I hope you'll go to the DVD and watch the performance.
Resources and materials available to anybody within the MSA?
Yes. We have all kinds of resource preparedness materials. I think in the packet that I gave you is the workbook, the Ready workbook that you can, if you decide you just want to hand out the workbook and not do all the performances or whatever, you can go on to readyhoustontx.gov and just order enough workbooks to hand out. You can also request a performance there. But if that's all you want to do is to get that in the hands of your parents, we can send you enough to get those distributed through your school. So, but we have all kinds of other preparedness material that we can assist you with.
Once an event happens or prior to an event, how do we get the word out to our constituents, to the public? And the center back in 1999 made a commitment to the districts to come up with some type of mass notification system called school alerts. And today we have Dan Timmons and Gene Sewell from Witt O'Brien to talk about the 2.0 version. They have done some enhancements to the system and we want to introduce it again to you. And I'm going to turn it over to Dan.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Glad to be with you on this one. I'm Dan Timmons. I'm the industry manager for technology solutions for Witt O'Brien. So those of us in the emergency management world probably recognize James Lee Witt's name. He was one of our founders. And so I've been 10 years of providing support using a platform called Peer Systems. It's used widely across the region by the mayor's office, by Judge Emmett's office. It's the web-based communication management platform used regionally. And as Mr. Brewley mentioned, probably 6 years ago, I sat down with previous leadership here at Harris County Department of Education, talked about a Safe School Alerts application that had been sort of put together out of need, but it was apparently not serving the purpose. So we started talking about peer supporting this incredibly important. I mean, how many folks had schools closed this past week through the rain event? And I'm a native Houstonian. And by the way, that's great information, Jackie. I wanted to thank you because I personally live and breathe this. And my elementary school daughter several years ago came home asking what our plans were. I went, we probably ought to have one. So you remind me again to dust off my plan. But anyway, the whole idea is in this county, we have 26 school districts representing, I'm told, 3,000 schools and affect 1 million children if I got the statistics right. And last time I checked, most of those kids have at least two parents. So, you know, there are a lot of stakeholders interested in the status of what is going on in our region, what schools are open and closed. So, as Mr. Burley mentioned, Peer initially supported in a pilot program for 4 years an application that ultimately needed to be rebuilt from the ground up. So for the last year, that's what we're talking about. If you don't mind, Gene. And by the way, let me introduce Gene Sewell as our product manager. He is really the brains of the outfit. I'm here as I've been coordinating with our client. But what you're looking at is a Safe School Alerts built on Peer Pro, which is a Web 2.0 application, much more dynamic than what, if anybody remembers the old Safe School Alerts, does anybody remember seeing that tool? It was functional. But I think you're going to find that this tool allows the superintendent of each district and their surrogates to be authorized users to be able to come in, log in, and quickly update the status of each school with special, and Gene will walk us through it, but the ability to stage openings based on we need faculty in today and students tomorrow, special notes, and all of the information added into this will now feed a Chiron feed to the media. So I noticed that a lot of schools that were closed, people were reading lists. We all know that without automating that, there can be some inaccurate information, confusion of schools, all the things that you guys know better than I do. So this is the external facing page, and the URL will be easier to get to than Peer Pro, Web, Web, whatever. It'll be safeschoolalerts.com. Yeah, okay. And you're seeing a depiction, a graphical depiction, using common operating platform. For those in emergency management, we've integrated to Esri's ArcGIS Online to represent the school's facilities And if you have an interest in using this plus button on the lower right side, you can add in layers. So if you want to bring in the railroads, city use of transportation, overlay information, your stakeholders have the ability to look at other things, flood challenges. Takes you on the map to the school, gives you the status. That's how easy it is for a homeowner, a parent or a teacher or a media person to look and check. We've also created a color code system. So quickly your eye goes to the green schools, they're business as usual. You have the red schools, they're closed. The yellow ones are in some state of between open and closed. And so you can click on any school, and you know what we wanted this tool to do, to be a very easy to use interactive tool that gets you the information that you want. Now I'm going to take a pause and ask Jeep to walk us in as if he were y'all's administrator and show what happens when you log in the process. So I'll step aside for a minute.
Thanks Dan. So what you see is the home page, like Dan explained, an interactive map with addition or choosing the layers that you want to see or not see. The search function, we saw that you can type in the school that you want the status for, and that's going to take you right into that school. The again, the red denotes that it's closed due to whatever the reason might be, and the green is the school's open as usual. So the next most important screen I would like to present is the all districts list. It gives you a list of all the ISDs, and as an end user, like a parent or guardian of a child, what that person would want to do is go to email notifications and would want to subscribe to the mailing list for that school. The objective being that that person would get notifications for whatever alerts that school might send. So, for instance, I'm going to choose Cyprus. Select element. It's going to present me with all the elementary schools for Cyprus. I'm going to choose, let's say, Bain.
So it allows a parent to really dial in type on those schools that their kids are attending. And just with a simple registration process, they can then subscribe to receiving emails, SMS, text to voice, depending on what you guys' side of the equation is putting out. So you hit submit.
So I put in my phone number, obviously, and my email address, but I registered as a parent for that school, and I just have to remember elementary. But that's all it takes to register to that particular school. What I'm going to do right now is log in as a school administrator, and we'll show you how sending notification is easy.
while Jeet's logging in, I think our goal is, because as Jackie reminded us, June 1st is beginning of hurricane season. So there's going to be a coordination effort to be sure we train up the districts in a quick fashion. And it is really straightforward. You'll see in a moment how simple it is to use this tool. So tell us what you do.
Okay, so as an administrator of that school, I went under administration, and I'll go with the other menus, but I just wanted to jump to send notification. And again, the screen is pretty straightforward. All I want to do is choose my school and that I want to send notification for. Over here, you have two options, public and private. You know, as the name suggests, public is to, the notification goes to all the general public, general end users. Private, if you want to send notification to internal administrators or any other group that you might, or the school might identify. So I'm going to hit public.
By the way, we've integrated this tool currently to Everbridge as an option. It's also integrated to our own in-house tools, but there's been a survey conducted that revealed that I think 15 of the 26 school districts are subscribers of School Messenger. I see a show of hands. Yep. So yeah, so the tool was built to be agnostic in that we can provide an API that can connect to School Messenger, and if there becomes even more uniform adoption of a single tool, you know, we're pretty much just want to make sure you guys have effective tools connected to our application.
So as you can see, there are three modes of notification. So I'm going to choose all and then hit submit.
So that could have gone to 20,000 people, depending on your contact database.
So it's going to ring my phone in just a few seconds here, but till then, let me just walk you through the other menus. All right, so the first one is the dashboard. You know, the homepage is the map, so as an administrator, you also get to see the map that end users saw. The dashboard gives you, quick, by the way, that was the text message. When it rings, I'm just going to put it on speaker. So here you can see there are four widgets. A quick glance of which schools are open, closed, or in the process, like Dan said. Notifications, you know, what kind of notifications were sent. Again, I'm sorry, I want to pause here.
If you copy and press 1 to hear this message. Hello, this is the test. Press 1 to confirm receipt.
So it kind of acts as a two-way communication. Also, you have a distribution report that the administrator can go and see which notifications passed or failed and take the right action. But just going back to the dashboard, again, you see the subscriber list, and on the right side, you see for that particular ISD, you know, it's just listing by alphabetical order. So like Bain Elementary, I subscribed during the demo, so it shows one subscriber and it also shows the statuses of the schools closed. So that's the dashboard view. Through the quick links here, manage facility. You can easily add a new school or a particular facility to that particular ISD. So that's done here.
Show them how they would adjust their school in particular.
Correct. Yeah. So on this screen here, again, it defaults alphabetically, so it's defaulting to the first one that's listed. But over here, you can select. You have the option of selecting all schools under that ISD and changing the status to whatever appropriate, either closed or delayed, and also giving the detail section the reason. So you can do that one school at a time. That to open and put in the appropriate details, or you can do select all and then you know, change the status and update all. So it's going to update everything. Again, that's pretty straightforward.
Because the original Safe School Alerts, we got a lot of feedback from you folks that were trained up in it. And I think hopefully what you're seeing is a completely new, very responsive, very easy to use, configurable system that can also take and utilize the mass notification solution that you're already subscribing to. So,
on this screen here, I want to show you two things. One is the option for RSS feed. So let's say your school has you know, a website that they have an RSS ticker that they want to consume. Safe School gives you that option to provide an RSS feed of the statuses. So your school website can consume that RSS feed. And then the Kimon version is really a cool part of the Safe School. As you can see, it converts it into the statuses of the schools that are closed or delayed into a Chiron version, which could be again consumed by the media and then, you know, can present in a ticker format or whatever format that you want to work with in the media. So, so that's that. I went through the send notification. Add subscription, again, it's pretty straightforward. You, as an administrator, you can also add subscription of the users to that particular ISP. ISP association, so if you want to create multiple groups, like administrator or overall administrator of the HCDE, and assign which ISDs you want to, you can do that through this screen.
Let me make a quick comment, is that this tool, this application was built in a format that's called responsive design. So it recognizes the appliance that you're accessing it from. So if I'm a parent, this will render beautifully on an iPhone or an iPad or my laptop. If I'm actually logging in, same deal, I can effectively toggle the status of my schools from home during an event. And it all rolls up to the city of Houston and Harris County that really want a one-stop shop for what is going on in our county. And one of the additional benefits of investing in a brand new application was the last iteration was tapped out. It was 26 school districts. This one is built to scale. And I think there's a strategy, and I don't want to speak on behalf of Mr. Burley, but I'm told that charter schools want to participate and that higher ed is very interested. And so now this one application can allow, as Jeet mentioned, to add additional participating groups, and now you have it all in one easy-to-use spot. And again, I've learned a lot as a parent. You know, I didn't realize that being in the NASA environment, if a school closes and a NASA person is coming from another part of the city, they've got to make arrangements for their kids. Y'all know this better than I do. But anyway, supposedly, or my hopes are that this meets multiple needs. It's, you know, makes accurate, timely information available to those people that want it. Parents, teachers, faculty, media, and emergency managers trying to coordinate. So we could probably spend more time, but there won't be a quiz, so you can relax. But I hope that in the near future, we'll be helping to coordinate the training so that you guys can keep your hand on the tool, and we hope it serves your needs. So, any questions? Yes?
Dan, you hit the nail right on the head for emergency management. I was glued to this site Monday night. So I strongly encourage the districts to use it. Katie, thank you, because you did use it. Monday, you had, we are watching the weather, and then you did post, our district is closed. That's the only site that we have to go to that is a one-stop site for emergency management. It is virtually impossible for us to go to all of the different districts and go on the individual sites to see what's going on with your schools. And now you're using Twitter, so now we have to go down and find your tweets to know if you're closed to school or not. It's very difficult for our offices of emergency management to know what's going on with your school district. So I love this site, I'm glued to it, but we need you to use it.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Comment is, think it's nice to map.
Yeah.
You automatically start seeing certain areas that will be closing and just for social reasons. Oh, being close to it. The other one is there going to be for the future a presentation that we can then do to the community on how to use this? If you guys want, you know, 5 minute
video.
Yeah. Yes.
Video or just PowerPoint presentation that we can then.
And Mr. Burley anticipated that and asked us to create.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. We wanted a self tutorial that, you know, just like when I was running Windows 8, I could go there and had it already on there for you, just click it and it would walk you through. You know, walking through how to use the system. So, you know, they're working on that piece.
How quickly are you doing that turnaround?
Sure. Well, pretty soon, I would say. I mean, you missed it. Already mentioned that. So it's in the process, I would say, by a week or so.
Okay, so yeah. by August.
Absolutely.
Long before that.
Yeah.
And as Ammy mentioned, it really is great to spend the time, less than an hour, learn this tool, get disciplined to use it. When what we've learned about a good software application, it makes life easier because you get a lot more done in a hurry, and it's accurate, it's out there, and then you can adjust on the fly. But it is linked off of, I know that some of the, like the Regional Joint Information Center has a button that says schools, and it was linked to the old Safe School Alerts. It will now reflect this as soon as we go live. And so I've heard other city and county leadership point to that school button for stakeholders to come to. So it is a one-stop shop. And you know, to the degree you guys, girls, will, ladies will use it, it'd be great.
So Harris County Department Head is going to this format then, is that what you're saying?
Well, we've had, this is a 2.0 version. We're trying to encourage the district to use it because we lost some traction a little bit. Over the last couple of years. And Cherie, I think you did a search. She went to each website, and very few of you have the information updated. So, you know, we want to reintroduce it to you. This is a new 2.0 version, and you've got to go back in there, though, and update your information and start using it again. Initially, when we introduced this a few years ago, we had 18 districts sign on to use it. And so we just trying to revitalize it again to you and let you know that it is a viable option out there and you can use it in support of something along with your membership here with the center. So we want you to use it. It's a great system. Cherie was going to be your point of contact on any issues you might have with it. So we'll be working with you to make it happen and make sure it's user friendly for you and it's serving the needs that you have.
So should we continue? I mean, we're using School Messenger aside.
Right. Right.
I mean, yeah. They've really locked into School Messenger. So this
right.
This would be in addition to the School Messenger.
You would have to reintroduce it to your public. And
conceptually, the website that your stakeholders can come to, and then if a decision made to link or integrate to your School Messenger, when you log in as your school district, then it would kick the messages out through your School Messenger service. So, you know, you can push information out, and then that information could say, for more information, come back to this website. And if you know, that's the concept of an interactive two-way communication.
And this is accessible on your laptop or iPad.
It's responsive design. It will
even on your phone.
Yeah, it'll format based on the real estate.
Is there an icon or application that you?
There's no app per se, but you know, since you mentioned, it's a responsive design, so you can very well access or browse through your smartphone to that.
So it's a URL. It's just a website address. They can come to it and then see what they need. If they don't, they can search for the school. Yes, sir.
It still pushes out the media. It still pushes out the person tomorrow.
Exactly. Yeah, and that's based on just setting it up for your distribution. That would be one of the private messaging. Well, we hope this meets the need. And again, Witt O'Brien's, one other comment, Mr. Burley and I were talking. Witt O'Brien's, in addition to technology, we provide the FEMA support for our clients, because James Lee Witt was head of FEMA, and so I hope you haven't had any damages, I hope you don't have a claim, but if we can ever be of service or support with FEMA closeouts or insurance resolution stuff. We do a lot of stuff. So I'll be around. If anybody has any questions, happy to fill in the blanks. But I appreciate the time in front of you today.
I just want to add one more point. The support on this, the help support, you know, we have 24 hours emergency line, you know, tier one, three level support. And you can either call us on that 24 hours line or email or, you know, submit an inquiry. It would be answered immediately. Our support is in Houston, you know, not anywhere else. So.
And I think that makes a real need to have it local where we can get to you then. That's outstanding.
Good. Thank you.
And we're going to be working with them to integrate it to School Messenger. Since many of you are already using School Messenger now, we want it to kind of be compatible. So we'll get more information out to you on that. And I wanted to bring up Harris County Public Health Environmental Services. Nathan Vessy is here today, along with one of his staff members. One of the things that we were working on was having them as a liaison to the school districts was with the pods, points of dispensing. And there's also a City of Houston version, there's Harris County, and he'll get into that. But one of the things that I had difficulty doing was knowing who to contact on the districts, because for whatever reasons, personnel change each year, and one of the things they wanted me to do was get the notice out for the call down the drill. And I couldn't do that as effectively as I wanted to because we did not have updated information. So this is very important. So please give it your attention.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I'm Nathan Vessy. I'm with Harris County Public Health and Environmental Services. I think I've spoken to many of you over the years, some of you more recently than others. So I'm here to talk to you a little bit about the Strategic National Stockpile Plan with Harris County Public Health today. And I'll touch for a few points on the City of Houston. They were going to be here today, but unfortunately they couldn't attend. So we all know, of course, the stuff about Harris County. We're huge, third or fourth, depending on how you measure us in the nation. That actually is huge with the Strategic National Stockpile. Is anybody here not familiar with the Strategic National Stockpile? I think I've spoken to almost all of you before. So public health in general, we're responsible for a great many things. Unfortunately, included in all the things, public health are terrorist events and other medical emergencies that affect the population of the county as a whole. So the Strategic National Stockpile is the giant cache of medicines available to shoot to us at a moment's notice at time of need. It includes a bunch of stuff, not just medicine. I've talked to you, many of you, about the antibiotic dispensing role of the Strategic National Stockpile. There are other pieces to that to supplement hospitals and other medical devices and things. The Strategic National Stockpile is, of course, requested through Harris County. It goes through the judge's office and then up to the state. The state makes the request of the federal program, and it's a very rapid response. Medicine, of course, from the Strategic National Stockpile is free to everybody. So the areas of responsibility with the Strategic National Stockpile are the federal government warehouses, keeps, maintains, purchases the material, and makes it available to us on request. The state of Texas makes the request. They are also responsible for receiving the material from the federal government and then in turn is giving it to us, and the local health departments are responsible for dispensing. Here in Harris County, that's two major health departments. That's the City of Houston, Health and Human Services, and Harris County Public Health. The Strategic National Stockpile, of course, comes in two pieces. One piece is like a piece of emergency equipment. It's sitting on the ground. Pre-packed, it's not aimed at any one particular problem. It is stuffed full of all kinds of pieces, some antibiotics, some neurological agents, some medical supplies, things like gloves and some other things that are in there, ready to go at a moment's notice. They tell us that that material can be here in less than 12 hours. It's called the 12-hour pushback. It's supposed to be here before 12 hours. Of course, because of its size, it's limited into what it has. pretty much aimed at first responders so we can get some material out there and get our pods open. The rest of it is managed inventory. Managed inventory is medicines, stockpiles of gloves, materials, medicines, and other supplies designed to ship to us once we identify the specific need that we need for that particular, whatever it is we're responding to. So the Harris County plan, and I'm going to speak about the Harris County bit because obviously we're not representing the city of Houston. Our plan is to put enough points of dispensing or public places where we're distributing medicine in the field to reach our portion of the population, which is about 2.5 million. We count the Harris County at about 5 million, 2.5 for the city and 2.5 for the county. That's a little more than the reported numbers because the state recommends that we account for more than we need by a little bit. It accounts for gas passing through and miscounts. We'd rather have more than not enough. So this is a short notice event. Most of the material that I talked to you about is centered around the anthrax scenario. This is a scenario where weaponized anthrax is released into the public from an unknown location, and it could spread far and wide. Anthrax, of course, as we probably know, is non-contagious. However, once you come in contact with the material, we have a very short window to get you on antibiotics before you wind up becoming so toxic you won't recover. So our objective is to get medicine into people very, very quickly. And that's the one we center around because almost everything else is a much slower paced thing. We'll come to you and say, hey, this is the problem. What do you think about this? In fact, some of you I've spoken to recently about the flooding. That's a similar type event. We call you up. It was rather hasty, but we did have a chance to talk to you and say, hey, what do you think about that? So the Harris County plan, we plan to open up two types of public dispensing. We have a drive-through plan, which is like going to McDonald's. It's actually going to the tents. We have little canopies that we shelter our staff under, and the public comes up and picks up their medicine. And we have the walkthrough plan. The walkthrough plan is the one that most affects you guys because most of our public dispensing locations are schools. Not all of them are schools. We also have the closed pods. The closed pods are large organizations that will dispense to their internal staff. They have to meet certain criteria, but you can think of some large businesses and that type of thing in the area. And there's also, of course, special pods. Special pods are for first responders, police, fire, emergency management, and other people that are involved directly in the response. And that may include you if you're part of our emergency dispensing program, then we'll actually ship the meds probably to your district if you've been selected. So not all the pods are in public schools. We do have a couple business partners and a church. We have interlocal agreements with most of you. We're in the process of re-signing those agreements right now. Many of you have probably seen that come through your desk here recently. The division line between Harris County and the City of Houston's plan is not exclusively the boundary of Harris County and the city. We've agreed in some places with the City Health Department where they're going to take some areas that are actually county. And a good example of that's down in the Clear Creek area. Clear Creek is gonna be handled by the City of Houston, and in turn, we're gonna handle most of Pasadena and that area in and around Galena Park and Deer Park. A-Leaf is another good example. We'll be taking all of Ammy. So Harris County, this is a map. This is our map of the pods. It's actually missing a couple. We have several locations surveyed within the county, about 56 locations now that have been surveyed as mass dispensing locations. Of course, we can't staff 56 locations, so we're looking at a little over 20 at the moment. Those are the colored dots. I didn't put names on these because they tend to move around. Sometimes the current thinking is we'll be here, and sometimes it's there. I do visit with many of you on a regular basis. Dr. Pods. The black dots represent the city of Houston. I believe they the city of Houston provided pod locations. Is that correct? Theirs don't seem to change as much as ours do. So the plan, and this is why we're here today, our plan has changed somewhat over the years. And the way we're going to get to these pods, get to you guys through these, is to do our notification through Harris County Department of Education. Obviously, once the balloon goes up on this, we will all be very busy. It's our intent to notify Harris County Department of Education that we're going to need schools for public dispensing. And we're hoping that this department will then be able to notify the districts directly. However, we maintain the database and the phone numbers and the contacts, and we should be able to contact each one of you individually if needed. Like I mentioned, there are pre-written plans for over 50 of these locations in the county. Some of them are older than others. The primary ones we're pretty much keeping up. Some of those more distant ones on the 50 list are beginning to get a little aged. So to give you an idea of what we're talking about, some of our pods, some of our public points of dispensing, we'll see in the 28,000 to 30,000 people over the 48 hours. That's what we think. And some of these locations are going to see around 350,000 people in that 48-hour period. So there's a big disparity between some of the districts and the others. And you guys know your districts, so I'm sure you can figure out where we're going to wind up concentrating efforts. We are evenly distributed through the county, though. This is an example of a walkthrough pod. When we tell you guys we're after your gymnasiums, that's what we're after. We have to have enough room to pass those people through where there's almost no delay. Each one of those is 24 lanes of dispensing, plus a couple special assistance lanes for those that need extra help. So the drive-through pods, this particular exercise was out at Berry Center. Berry Center makes a great place for drive-through location, huge parking lot. There are a couple others, M.O. Campbell's on that list, some private entities that have offered up their large parking lots for this kind of thing. This is a less of an impact on you as a district, I hope, because we will only be in a parking lot. We won't have to be in your building much. We still need room for staff. We still need to be able to house medicine, but we're hoping to keep the public out of your building. We're expanding this program, by the way. We've added quite a few in the last 7 years. So that's about all I have, but I do want to make sure that you know how to get hold of us. I have my contact information is out to most of you. We recently sent it out with all the agreements. The ones I want to point out, of course, we have a new preparedness specialist, Jennifer Kiger. She joined our team earlier this year. She's certainly available for questions and her contact information. The other two are with the city of Houston. Kirsten Short and Jeffrey Floyd, many of you have spoken to them, especially anybody with HISD, Aldine, who else? Aileen. I can't remember all. But anyway, please contact us with information or stop us and talk to us. We'll be happy to meet with you anytime. And that's all I have. Thank you. Yes?
And can we get access to your PowerPoint?
Yes, actually it's on the drive here. Do you have something to store it on?
No.
Okay. Mr. Cuddy, if you email me, I'll send you something.
Thank you.
What information specifically are you looking for?
I have a brand new superintendent, and I just need to walk him through what this is all about.
So that's the other thing, right? We're available to you guys anytime you have new staff, new superintendents, or we're looking for training for any of your staff. Please contact me. We'll be happy to make arrangements to come out and make a presentation, bring you some more materials, and answer your questions. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
I'm just curious if we're hot, because Dayton ISD, we're in Liberty, we're a little bit in Harris County. And I know we work with the state for the high school for the anthrax, but I'm not sure if Harris County is.
Okay, so there's one thing I didn't mention because it doesn't usually come up in my presentation. The plan is to have the entire region open as one. So if the city of Houston gets hit with an anthrax attack, there are actually, I don't recall how many counties, it's like around 10 or 11 counties? 17 counties that will open up their mass dispensing point at the same time. So you may not be with Harris County, but you could be with your own. And I can't speak for their plan, it's something similar. And we talk often. We talk to them quite a bit.
So we're dealing with the state, we're not dealing with Harris.
Because we you deal with the region, right? Is that Jennifer? Jennifer came from the state, so she's an excellent resource to ask.
Liberty County is really the same, we do the same procedure that Harris County is doing, we've been working on
So there is an important note there. We've added a district since we started this, which is very unusual. We've added Waller. Is Waller here by any chance? No?
No.
Waller ISD is actually not in, it's in Waller County, not Harris County, but their district actually falls within a good chunk of Harris County. The area out there is expanding so much, we've actually added them to our dispensing list. We're gonna work out with them some. Anybody else? Thank you guys very much.
Touch on the radio thing, hopefully for one of the last times, if not the last time. As y'all are aware, a few months ago, Center provided upgraded radios. We had to make that conversion because all the handhelds that the Center previously issued out would not work on the new digital platform. So now a couple of updates since y'all do have the new radios in place. Inside of your folder is a yellow card. We have received several phone calls from districts a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, it seems like. We used to do a radio test once a month. We haven't done that in a while because basically the center did not have staff that was always available in the office on Wednesdays. Now that we have some full-time positions, we are going to start doing the monthly radio test again. It'll be the same format that we used previously. It'll be the third Wednesday of every month. These are the dates that we have proposed for this year. So whoever's going to be doing your radio test, please get this scheduled to them. We are going to start this month later on. First day should be June 17th. So be looking for that, and we are going to start tracking who plays and who doesn't, so we can see, kind of ring your bell and not hear from you for a while. Didn't want to touch on one thing that some of y'all may or may not be aware of. For several years, Harris County IPC, the radio shop, what we call it, has been getting a lot of grant money, but I'll make a long story really short. Over the past few years, some of that grant money has gone away. The cost that users on the radio system are having to pay and had to pay for a long time is $12.75 per month. Effective March 1st next year, that is going to be going up to $39 a month per unit. That is a dramatic increase. They have lost a lot of their grant funds. And inside the folders, there is a PowerPoint that the gentleman from IDC sent over to me. Should be in there, kind of gives you all an explanation, justification why they're doing this. Harris County IDC basically has been operating in the red for several years now. They can no longer continue to do that. So they are gonna have to charge and raise up the user fees. Labor costs, repairs, things like that are not gonna go up. It's just going to be for the user fee itself. Again, it's going to kick in on March 1st. Hopefully this will allow people some time to get in there, maybe do some budget adjustments if they need to. One thing that y'all can do, I know this is kind of a big jump to hit y'all with at one time, y'all still have the old radios that the center issued out several years ago that no longer should be working on the county system. If you have not called down there and told them to deactivate this unit, you're still paying for that. So if y'all have a bunch of radios down there that you are no longer using, it doesn't necessarily have to be the radios that the center has. Any radio equipment that you have that you are no longer using, need to make sure they can, call down there and they deactivate it. Because unless they know about it, you're still paying that fee every month. So hopefully that will help the district recoup some of the costs when the price increase goes up. The gentleman that we have been talking to from the radio shop, named Robert Howard, they're having some user group meetings coming up to hopefully ease some pain for this transition. If anybody is interested in participating with that user group, they're absolutely encouraging y'all to do that. I do have his contact information, so if anybody wants to be involved in this transition process, please let me know, and we'll get you in touch with the gentleman over the radio shop. Any questions?
Are we planning for airtime on leave?
Yes, you are. The only thing the center pays for is basically to supply the radios to y'all. Airtime should be at your expense. If you drop, break them, any accessories, all that's at the district expense.
Your fees and all that good stuff.
Definitely. Yep. Any other questions about the radios?
Yeah.
Who are they billing?
Yeah.
That's a question.
Good afternoon. Wow. That was sad.
Good afternoon.
Thank you. Today is June 1st, and I get excited about it. It's hurricane season. This is what I live for. Yeah, there you go. Woohoo! It's hurricane season. Coming off a rainy day, I am psyched, man. Okay, June 1st, hurricane season, first day, and we're waiting on lunch. So you get me. I'm going to start by talking a little bit about history of hurricanes, and it's going to make sense when I end my presentation. Okay, how many of you remember Alicia? Were you here? I wasn't here. I'm from Michigan, so if I say some words, you'll understand why I say you guys, okay? Alicia. Category 3, at the time, was known to do the most damage. Galveston was late in ordering the evacuation for that. They only did the inland. By the time they decided, holy cow, it was too late. The bridge was already covered in water. We learn from our past mistakes. Tropical Storm Allison. It seems like we just relived that the other day. They kept referencing Tropical Storm Allison the other day. It was only a tropical storm. It had its name retired. The only tropical storm to have its name retired that's not a hurricane, because of the amount of damage and stuff it did to our area. Katrina Rita. We call it the Katrina effect, because what we saw Louisiana go through during Katrina, we panicked when Rita came, and everybody and their sister evacuated. Beyond Magnolia, where I'm from, evacuated. And then Humberto. That storm, that hurricane, is known for suddenly developing. We went to bed and woke up with a hurricane in the Gulf. It surprised us. They can develop that quickly. Sometimes we don't get our 120-hour notice that we like. So these are hurricanes I want us to remember. Hurricane season begins today. What do we say? I'm right! And excited! Woo! And it goes until November 30th. Our peak is September 10th. So we hold our breath until September. After September 10th, we get a little toddy, because we think we made it. We kind of start breathing a little bit easier. Last year was just kind of a gentle season in the life of an emergency manager. There was only predicted eight named storms. Out of those eight storms, they said six of them would be hurricanes. And out of those six, two would be major. That means it'd be a 3, 4, or 5. So you can see how 2015 compares to last year. Very similar. We predict there'll be 7 named storms. When we say name, we give it the A through Z name. Out of those 7, 3 will be hurricanes. And out of those 3, 1 will be major, category 3, 4, or 5. And that comes out of those wise people from Colorado, University of Colorado. They sit and they study.
Colorado State,
thank you. They sit and they study the weather, the temperature, and our Atlantic Ocean is warm this year, which we'll call it the El Nino effect, which means the water are warmer. During that time, sometimes it can cause more rainy, which we experienced. And then there's the 30-year average. But for this hurricane season, again, not so scary for us. Very similar to last year. How did last year impact us? Did it impact us? I don't even remember getting a storm. But what we need to remember is it only takes that one storm This is a lot of things that happen throughout the United States. A lot of different paths that can happen. The reason I wanted to show you the history of hurricanes of the past, 1983 up to 2007, is because even though they're predicting a pretty quiet season, all of these storms happened during a pretty quiet season. They all happened during an El Nino effect. It only takes that one storm. Sometimes, like the Memorial weekend, it doesn't even take a storm. It just takes a rain event to impact our schools, our communities. We can prepare all we want in emergency management. We can have the best written plans. But the unknown will always remain are the people themselves. How will they react in any given situation? We can tell them to stay at the Toyota Center. But will they? We can tell them to get a kit. We always encourage them to have more than one kit. We tell them to put a kit in their car because we don't know where they'll get stranded at. Make a plan. When I go out and do outreach, I tell them you need to not only have a plan at your home, but you need to have a plan from your workplace to your home. Stay informed. Yes, it's likely we'll have a quiet season, but when it starts to form in the Atlantic, you need to stay informed. And then be involved. Jackie did a wonderful presentation on seeing how you can be involved. The CERT program is a great way to be involved. Our website, www.readyharris.org, during any emergency, is a great website. Gives you live, accurate information. It has a little tally going across, thing going across it. I'm not a techie. But it'll give you live information. So hurricane season. I don't care what Colorado State predicts. Because it only takes one. Again, we're predicting a quiet season. One major hurricane. But in the past, it's proven it only takes one to devastate our area, to impact our communities. A rain event can impact our community. What questions do you have? Yes, sir. I don't, but I will leave it here and they can email it out to you.
We can do that.
Any other questions? Ask me some questions. It's hurricane season. You know what? Normally I bring that list because everybody wants to know the names, and I did. I'm sorry. I do know there's a Larry, and I do know there's a Bill because they are both my bosses at the office, and so we are betting on those names to be the ones that impact us.
First one was Anna. We already have
it. Oh, there you go. Thank you. I always do have that list, too. I can stand up here and do the best presentation ever, and that's what they want to know. One thing I do want to share with you is that I am your liaison for emergency management, and I do have my cards on the back of the table. It's been a while since I've been out and really have communicated with the school districts, probably since Ike. So I just wanted to remind you that I am your emergency management liaison between the school districts and our office. So again, it's Amy Giezark, my cards are back there. And if ever you have any questions about anything related to emergency management or any question you just don't know where to find the answer, please always reach out to me. I am your resource.
My name is Michelle Sachs. I'm the Safe Schools Manager over at Crime Stoppers of Houston. And if you've ever heard me speak, then you know that I think I have like the coolest job ever. And for those who don't know me, I used to be a teacher. I started my teaching career back in 2001 in the Gulfton area of HISD, okay? So I worked the trenches just straight out of school. And very few know this, but the very first year that I was teaching, I wasn't a mom yet, but first year teacher, and as some of you guys know, schools become really overcrowded. Our school actually wasn't ready yet. They were building our school at the time, so they spread us out within three other elementary schools in the area. And the one we were at, I didn't feel was maybe the safest. They weren't making really good safe decisions during dismissal more than anything. And we would speak up, right? Even being a new teacher, I've always advocated for safety and just didn't feel, I thought it could flow better, right? And they told us that it wasn't our school, we were to stay quiet and just to follow their rules. And when we got into our school, we could do whatever we wanted. Well, in November of that year, we ended up losing a student, all right? And sadly, it was one of our students. Not that it matters, but it did to us. And that changed me, and that changed the way that I view school safety as a whole. And then I became a mother, right? And that changes everything. And my kids are at HISD right now, and I always say that it's not enough for me to make sure that they come home safely. I want to make sure everyone's kids come home safely. So I worked in HISD, but I also worked at SciFair for a long time before joining the nonprofit world, right? The lucrative nonprofit world. So that is what I do for Crime Stoppers of Houston. Now, on a personal note, again, because I advocate so much for safety over at HISD, they did make me board co-chair, I guess, for the SHAC this year, which is the Student Health Advisory Council. So I always tell people, for HISD, so if you guys ever have any questions or need any help with that, I believe me, I'm well versed. Okay. It's okay. And I typically ask, how many of you guys are Houstonians? Okay. How many of you guys have heard of Crime Stoppers? All right, I would hope so. Okay. And how many of you guys know what we do besides the tip line? A couple. Okay. All right, well, that's fine. Okay, so if you understand how we really work, most of you guys know that we're not a division of law enforcement. Every time I go out to schools, I always have to tell them I am not a police officer. Now, the funny thing about that is that I do have an HPD badge because I work with White Hat, with Chief McClellan, so he badged me. And sometimes at schools, they'd rather me wear that, and I'm always telling them, look, I'm not an officer. When I wear it, I feel like people think I am. So I always have to tell them that we're nonprofit. And let's see here. Just gonna keep going. For those who don't know, we were founded a long time ago by the Exchange Club. We were modeled after a program in Albuquerque. I'm gonna tell you right now, what sets us apart than anyone else is the programs that we do have. Most Crime Stoppers out there really do just run this tip line. And forever, when it came to Safe Schools, all we did was go out to schools and talk about that tip line. So for those who were familiar with our programs in your schools or in your districts, then you know that that's what we used to go out and do. I'm sorry, guys, I'm hot. We used to just go out there and talk to you guys about how to report and talk to your students about how to report and how to keep their school safe. But now we do things a lot differently, and we're going to get to that. So the solving arm of Crime Stoppers, of course, is our tip line. And then we also have the Fallen Hero Project, which means, as many of you guys know, we give out up to $5,000 in cash rewards if your tip leads to an arrest, or in my school cases, if it leads to any type of school discipline. But when it comes to our officers, if anything happens to one of our officers or one of the first responders in the line of duty, and someone is at large, then that $5,000 is automatically doubled to $10,000, okay, which is a huge incentive. So that's on the solving arm. So we have our phone number that everyone knows, 713-222-TIPS. Our partner agencies are HPD, the Sheriff's Department, Metro, and Pasadena. These are the guys that answer the phone. You don't want me answering the phone, all right? So we have trained investigators that do this. We call it the detail office, and it's actually manned by HPD. So whenever someone calls the tip line, then they know exactly what to ask for. So anyway, I always like to give them credit. Now we are open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We receive about anywhere between 2,500 and 3,000 calls a month, all right? You can report four ways now, so it's not just the phone number anymore. You can go through the website, you can text us, and we have this lovely mobile app, which I'm telling you right now, for students, is a really big deal. Okay, you can send in your tips through, you can text them, you can send in videos, you can send in photos, and I'm gonna tell you right now, we get a ton of video from your bathrooms. A lot of shady things happen in your bathrooms. There's typically not a lot of supervision in there, right? I've seen more than I've ever wanted to see from those. But, and two, for those who are familiar with iWatch, right? Because Sheriff, God, I still call him Sheriff Garcia, although my daughter right now calls him future Mayor Garcia. But when iWatch came out, right, we had everyone see the little poster. The difference between iWatch and the Crime Stoppers app, of course, is that if you go directly through the Sheriff's Department, then they know exactly who you are. It's not anonymous. Now, whenever you heard Sheriff Garcia out there talking about how his app was anonymous, the reason he would say that is because we're on the app. So if you go to send a tip, you will see Crime Stoppers on the corner. You have to click Crime Stoppers and send your tip through us for it to be anonymous and to be eligible for the cash. Sheriff Garcia, I guarantee you, is not going to give you cash. Neither is Sheriff Newman. So that's the difference. So when you guys see those, I wanted you to know what that was. These are just stats. Oh, this is something else that I always love to tell people. We've paid out over $10 million in cash rewards. That money comes from criminals, okay? So whenever people donate money to us, or you see that, because we've been getting funding lately, so when you see that I get funded or there's private donors that come in, that money actually goes to the school program, it goes to our community programs. That's what it goes to. Not one penny of that goes to pay tipsters, all right? So whenever you have someone who is in the court system and they get put on probation, they have to pay a fee to Crime Stoppers directly. It's not like they pay the court and the court pays us. It's either $25 or $50 that they have to pay directly to us. And a lot of them are there thanks to a Crime Stoppers tip, so oh, the irony, right? So that's our fallen hero project, which I told you guys about. So significant cases, I'm going to tell you just about a couple. In February, this one right here was kind of a little dear to me only because it was a district that I worked really, really closely with. And I had gone out there, and you're going to see in a second, I'm not a huge fan of assemblies, all right? As much as I love a big crowd cheering me on, not my thing, all right? Especially because they don't get to ask questions. But this particular school loves for me to come in, talk to all the students, and then they have me come back out later. So I had gone to the school, I talked to them about different ways to report and that I'd be back later. Well, there was a guy in the crowd who didn't speak English, all right? So not very effective if you don't understand what I'm saying. So this kid was being bullied. He's in high school, he was getting bullied on the bus, he was getting physically assaulted on that bus every day. Now, he had immigrated here, he hadn't been in the United States, he had less than a year. He'd come over from one of the Central American countries, he and his brother. And the people that were victimizing on the bus were heavily tattooed, which in his country is pretty scary. So he decides to bring a gun to school, okay? Now he must have shown it to someone or someone knew about it, but somebody called Crime Stoppers to alert us of this. So now, again, this is just ironic, but my cousin works at that school and she's the token Hispanic like I typically am as well. And so they called her over because the student was speaking English and they told her, look, you need to talk to him. He has something on him, you know, Crime Stoppers called him. So she talked to him and he finally admitted that yes, he had brought this gun to school and he had it really well hidden because the reason they called her over was they couldn't find it at first, you know, when they first tried, they couldn't find it, but they found it. And he had two loaded clips. So what really scares me about this is that if you were just trying to scare someone, why is it loaded and why do you have two extra clips, right? So anyway, again, that just happened. A lot of the things that we do find, we, you know, typically isn't publicized. The Star shooting back in 2013. This one right here, the guy actually fled, but it was still a Crime Stoppers tip, and they found him in Plano. And then this was one I always show to students, right? Because sometimes they don't realize that, you know, vandalizing and graffiti and those things are felonies. So we always talk about how this guy, this guy right here, who did this, actually took a picture of it, all right? And they put it on Instagram and was bragging about it. Now, not sure if he didn't know that that was illegal or he was just really proud of his work. But somebody sent it in as a web tip, and that's how they caught that guy. So those are just some of the cases that that kind of affect our students. So the prevention, arm, like I said, you know, we talked about the solving arm piece. But prevention's key, right? You know, we try to prevent all these crummy things from happening to our kids. But we do have our Safe Community Program. We have our Mothers Against Crime, which is pretty obvious. Bless you. And then you have me. You have the Safe Schools Program. So we've been around since 1997. And like I said, up until last year, it was just us talking to kids about tip line. It is free for all schools. I'm available to anyone. I don't care what it is. It's just, I just need a group of kids, all right? I've worked a lot with the National Charity League this year, so I've actually had to go to people's homes where they have like TVs and everything set up for me so that I can talk to their daughters and mothers at the same time. I'll talk to Cub Scouts. I'll talk to anyone who will listen to me. So it doesn't necessarily have to be a school. Right now, because it's summer, we're booking up right now for like different school programs, like summer programs. Some of them are at churches, some of them are at your schools. They're everywhere, right? So as long as there's a spot on the calendar, then you just book away. Awards. Okay, now I didn't want to just put myself on the slide here, but as many of you guys know, Crime Stoppers, every year we have not only our gala, but we have a luncheon where we honor people that have helped us, volunteers, corporations, you name it. So last year, I was getting a little upset afterwards because I work with, again, some of you in here and with so many people in Harris County and in greater Houston, and you guys do a ton to keep our kids safe. So I complained and said that I felt like we were not represented and that we need an award ourselves. So this year, we added the Safe Schools Award, okay? So that was my pride and joy. Well, then what was even funnier was that it ended up getting more nominations than any of the other categories, okay? And these awards have been given out forever, like for years. So I was very, very proud of that. So the nominating committee came to me and they're like, Michelle, you gotta help us with this. You're the one that works, you know, you work with these people. We don't know who everyone is. You gotta help us like at least narrow it down. I'm like, okay. So I'm looking at this, Chuck Norris pops up. I'm like, come on, right? But no, he actually really has a good program. It's called Kickstarter Kids. And I've worked at a couple of the schools where that program is. And we had really, 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 really good nominations. And I put them in the list, but I also put a district. There was a school and there was a person is what I narrowed it down to. And they ended up picking Chuck. And he actually showed up with his wife. And I don't know if you guys noticed, but she's actually wearing her Kickstarter shirt. I mean, talk about passion and talk about trying to keep kids safe, right? So anyway, he was pretty cool, and then these were just our honorees. But anyway, that was something. And I know it's just those little things, but again, I just feel like sometimes we need to be, there's people out there that need to be recognized for the things that they do to keep our kids safe. So up to date, we've solved about 2,000 school cases, and we removed almost 300 weapons off campuses, all right? And some of the stuff we find is crazy. I mean, forget guns, yes, we don't need guns at school. But like double-edged knives and just crazy stuff that people bring to school. So every day or every week or month, I have to look at that report and be like, really? Now when I talk to students, I always tell them the main reason that students do bring weapons on campus, right, is because they don't feel safe. For whatever reason, they don't feel safe. I can give you statistics all day long, right? There's studies that are done here in Houston thanks to the CDC every year. And so I know why they're doing it. So I always tell them if there's something that's making them feel unsafe, then that's a call that they need to make. Don't bring anything on campus that's gonna get them into trouble. Okay, so our programs now satisfy state and federal mandates related to anti-victimization, cyberbullying, and recognizing and reporting child abuse in the class. So our Safe Schools 101 program. So this is where I come out, especially for like middle and high school kids. I have videos that we bring out. And we just made 4 new ones. I am super excited. Memorial High School helped me out on this. Their students in their drama department were our actors. So now we have videos on bullying. We have one on human trafficking, cyberbullying, alcohol abuse, teen dating violence, domestic violence, drug activity at school, and an abuse in all forms. So basically what you do is with this one, if you're like, okay, Michelle, I need you to come out, I typically will ask what kind of problems you're having or what kind of issues you guys are dealing with in your district or at your school. And you just pick. There's no way for me to walk up by any means. But I can typically get to like 3 or 4 in like 30 to 45 minutes. And the way that the videos are set up is that it sets up a scenario. And we start talking. This is why I like to do just like a couple of classes at a time or one classroom at a time. So we start talking. I try to kind of feel them out on what their knowledge base is on some of these issues. So then we talk about like, okay, would you do something in this situation, right? So then the videos will take you two ways. It'll take you to what could potentially happen if nothing's done. And then it'll show you how easy it is to do something and then of course like the outcome of that. And I'm gonna tell you right now that not all of these are called a Crime Stoppers. These are not Crime Stopper commercials in any shape or form. Because my primary focus is safety and I wanna make sure that these kids are making good decisions and that they're staying safe. It's not always a call to us, okay? It's just a call to action in general. So anyway, we do have those available. Internet safety. This one is keeping me crazy busy because as you know, these kids love pictures and inappropriate content. So I use NetSmarts, which some of you guys may or may not be familiar, but it's through the Center of Missing and Exploited Children, right? I've been doing it for 3.5 years, close to 4 years now, and I can't tell you how many presentations I do a year. Every quarter I report to them and they are always astonished at how many schools we hit. What I like about this program is that I can talk to kids from kinder all the way to 12th grade, and then I also talk to parents. So typically I will go and hit an entire school, and then after I hit those students, then I will go and speak to their parents afterwards. And I don't sugarcoat it, and I don't show them the parent presentation. I show them the exact same thing I just showed their kids, okay? And we're giving them actual skill on what to do to keep their kids safe, because a lot of them are putting their own kids into danger, and they don't know. They don't know that some of the things that they do and post can be kind of dangerous. So we're doing this one a ton. And it's in English and Spanish, which is also nice, because even if I go and present to an entire school in English, their parents don't speak English, so we can go in and do it in Spanish. So great, great program. I also use examples from here in Houston. So for anyone who's ever seen it, you've never seen me do it, okay? Because the center will even tell you, I don't do it the way it's scripted. I do it a lot differently. I work with the Texas Attorney General, and I work with their cyber crimes unit to make sure that we're giving like up-to-date and good examples from here in the area. Okay, so reporting and recognizing child abuse and neglect. Now, this one is kind of dear to my heart only because I was a teacher, okay? And I'm gonna tell you, every time I taught at any school, I was always told if something happened, you go and you talk to the nurse or you talk to the principal. Now I know that that's highly illegal and I could have been put in jail, especially at the schools I worked at because I've only always worked Title I schools, okay? So we will go out and speak to your staff. Now I know a lot of them now go to doing it online. You can do it online. In the past, most people call because something's come up or they're having some kind of issue and they want me to come talk to their teachers. But I have had some schools already book this for fall because they're being proactive. And again, it's free. They can ask questions. You know, we work really closely with CPS to make sure that that we're up to date on everything. And then responding to disclosures, right? So not just how to report, but also how to react to it. Okay, so implementations in schools, training for law enforcement, school staff, etc. This is something we've been doing for a long, long time. So the first Friday in August, so this year is August 7th, it used to be called law enforcement training, okay? But then when I came on board, I was like, what is this? It's not just for law enforcement, and what am I training you to do, right? So I changed the name, all right? So it's campus-based safety training is what I call it. And it's 4 hours, it's from 9 to 1. You get 4 TCOL credits, and it's open to anyone who wants to know what's going on, and I'm gonna tell you who our speakers are this year. But there's free breakfast and free lunch, okay? And again, it's open to anyone. The Aramco always gives us their auditorium, and I think it only houses like 90 or 99. So you do have to email me just to register your spot, okay? But this year we have, the district attorney comes every year. I do try to get Devin to come in. If she's available, she will come. If not, she'll send someone else. But what they do is that they give updates on new juvenile laws and things like that that you need to be abreast of. Who else do we have? I think we have HPD coming to talk about mental health in schools and what we can do about that. The Sheriff's Department, their canine unit's coming out this year. I'm super excited. So we have Officer Sean Brown with I think he's bringing Brett. He should be Brett, or bring the dog. So that should be pretty cool. You'll hear from me always, you know, on just what we're doing and what new things have come out. So we try to give you guys as much information as possible. So it's not really a training per se. So it's more of a just kind of informational thing. And again, you get T-Cole credit and free food. Let's see here. So again, we do present to students, staff, anyone. And you know, as far as parent presentations, again, it's not just the internet one. Sometimes schools will call, and one thing I've been doing a lot of lately is like, is drug abuse and alcohol abuse and like the signs and symptoms, what can they do? I've gone out to talk about gangs, anything like that, anything that deals with safety and deals with trying to keep them out of trouble, then we can go out and do that. That's not a problem. And again, we can do it in English and Spanish. The app, I talked about the app a second ago, right? Which, if you ever download it, it's Crime Stoppers Houston. As many of you know, there's a bajillion Crime Stoppers in the nation. So in order for it to come to us, you gotta type in Houston. And I gave you guys the difference between that and iWatch. The metal signs, you know, you see these signs everywhere. This year, just like 2 months ago, I actually changed them to reflect the safe schools. So that way it just looks a little different than the ones that you see in the parking lot at Walmart, right? So these are available free of charge too, and they're a different material because sometimes I drive around and I see like all of them missing. All you see is the phone number because they're so faded. So you can always call me. I will drive them out to you. I will tell you, I do have a superstar ISD. I don't know if they're in the house, but I love Klein ISD. So head of security called me and they said, you know what? I made a list for you. So what they did was that they contacted every elementary, middle, and high school. And they had this beautiful Excel spreadsheet on whether they needed signs, that they needed posters, whatever it was they needed. So I went and hit 26 schools in one day and made sure that they got everything they needed. So kudos to Klein for helping me and doing that. So you can always do that, just call me. This is the flyer for the training that the summit that I was telling you guys about, again, from 9 to 1. We're going to post this really, really soon, but you can just email me. Like, if you know you're coming or you want to come, just email me. I brought cards, and you can do that. So successful partnerships. Again, I have some ISDs that we have really good relationships, right, and some that I don't work with as much as I'd like to. You know, it's promoting us, encouragement really on both sides, distributing materials. So. Part of keeping the community safe is not just in schools, but everyone, right? So part of our safe community is that we have safety initiatives each month. So if you're not on my email list, then you need to be on there because each month I will send out whatever the safety initiative is. So I'll just give you an example. April was busy, right? Because it was child abuse prevention, so we have child abuse prevention tips. I also threw out tips out there for school staff on the recognizing and reporting, like that one pager, sent that out. There was safety tips on sexual assault prevention, and then also prom safety, right, since it was April. So all that got sent out. Now, what we're working on for summer, and I did bring you guys some, I put them on the desk. These are summer safety tips. So right here, it tells you about summer camps, being home alone, hiring a sitter, keeping kids in a hot car, cyber safety, bike safety, water safety, heat safety, you name it, that's all on here. This one's summer travel tips. And just to kind of show you an example, I did bring the bullying awareness initiative, so these were our bullying safety tips, just so that you can kind of see what they look like. Now, I send these out. Some districts don't do anything with it. Some of them do distribute it. Some of them distribute to staff. These can be distributed or disseminated however you want, but this is just something else that we do each month. To make sure that, again, the community is staying safe. All right. Do you guys have any questions? Anyone? Yes, yay!
Okay, so we're in Dayton.
You're in Dayton. We're in Dayton.
There you go.
If you watch the news, we have a cattle drive through our city yesterday. We are a little bit in Harris County. We're mostly in Liberty County.
Okay, as long as you're at least a little bit in Harris County, then we're okay.
Okay, that's all.
Because this is what I do now. I try not
to. Yeah, cattle drive safety, because that was
it. I did see that.
Yeah,
I
was us.
I can work on that. As long as you're kind of within and around Harris County. If you're not in Harris County, then what I'll do is I'll work with you. Like, for instance, Stephen Squire over at like Montgomery County, like I work with him pretty closely. So it depends on what it is. Like they're trying to get like a school program up and running over there. But if it's something like it's just like community type stuff, then typically I'll call Officer Squire and he'll go out and do it. So it just kind of depends. Like Fort Bend, they don't have a school program. They really honestly just run that tip line, right? It's owned by the Sheriff's Department. But we have been doing a little bit of work on there. And this is actually really cool. 2 weeks ago, I think it was 2 weeks ago, we went out to Austin Parkway Elementary in Fort Bend, and 104 KRV came out with me, their morning show. So I trained them. So Rula and Ryan, if you guys are familiar, again, they're on the morning show. The three of us did it together. And then one of the producers was out in the crowd with the fourth and the fifth graders with the microphone. So anytime I would ask a question, they had it. So they ended up airing this thing. So we do work a little bit in some of the other counties. It just kind of depends. But this is something that 104 really wanted to do. And they had a personal tie to that particular school. Which is why we went out and did it. So again, just call me and we'll work it out. I just want to make sure that no one needs me in greater peace. Anything else? Okay, again, I brought plenty of business cards and the safety initiatives. Just want to take them so you can see what they look like. And I hope to see all of you guys on August 7th. Again, it's free of charge. Just email me and let me know you're coming so that we can reserve a spot for you.
But this is important. We'll do this more often next year for our best practices. Just so you guys are practitioners. So we have a practitioner out here today. It's my pleasure to introduce Chief David Kimball from Klein ISD. He's brought some of his officers with him to talk about a program that they're doing out there to work with their staff with security and safety. Chief, welcome.
Great. Thank you. Hey, good morning. Or actually, lunchtime. You know, I couldn't decide if I wanted to be in front of lunch or during or after lunch. You know, Jan, you're just not the same. That was what I kept seeing that old Snickers commercial thinking of. As I said, I'm David Kimberly, Chief of Police, Klein ISD. Before we get started, I'm going to be sending some of these guys out of the room, so I'd like to introduce the true all-stars here. That's going to be Captain James Andrew, Officer Roger Deering, and Officer Haggard. She's going to be our victim today. What we've developed is we've developed a program. It's called Klein ISD Street Smarts. And let me get a deal here. We'll try to be brief. I don't want to get between you and get out of here either. Basic things we're going to really cover here is intruderology. Anybody familiar with that? It's a run, hide, fight model. And then situational awareness, basic defensive tactics, and then college battle. With that, the intruderology, after Sandy Hook, you know, every few years we have a Columbine, we have a Sandy Hook. Sandy Hook was obviously really woke us up for the fact that it was an outsider, not someone internally doing it. And it, you know, it caused us in our district, we turned around and the Safety and Security Committee, we met with the community, we did, you know what most of you guys did. And as a result, we came up with intruderology. And the goal there was to train all 6,000 of our employees in the run, hide, fight model. Now, mind you, that's a pretty monumental task. So working with our executive director, school administration, Mr. Webster, we certified 14 of our officers to teach it, and then we took it back out to the principals for them to teach it. And we did some videos. We worked with the Rats Fighters group and got that accomplished. And what we found when we started out in these trainings is you've got poor old teachers and they're going, well, what about, what if? And we heard that time and time again. We heard so much, what about, what if, what should we do? Because we can, the run's easy. The high, you know, we've changed our philosophies here. It used to be everybody just hid, you know, no matter what the situation was. You didn't have to think or compete. And of course, the fight. So when you get into the fight, trying to explain to these educators, you know, improvised weapons, how to, you know, what are you gonna do? And we kept hearing it. Well, we found that we didn't really have enough time in a 20 to 30 to 45 minute presentation on the road to really address those topics. So Officer Deering came to me a long time ago, and he's been teaching our officers pressure point tactics. So as a result, when he came to me, I said, hey, let's do this, let's take it to the next level. Let's offer this to our staff. Let's go out and offer it to our community. So we've had church groups, we've had all kinds of different groups that we'll put our guys in the red man suits, and we'll go out and we'll teach them very, very basic situational awareness, and then on top of that, we'll teach them very basic defensive tactics. You know, when we were, I'm gonna step back a second, I'm looking at my notes here. You know, some of the questions, again, were small. How are we gonna do this? You know, the teachers were concerned that they're, but everyone has soft tissue issue areas, and so believe me, you can take time to stop. So anyhow, Street Smarts, got, that's where it got born. We initially started with situational awareness. And again, schools are safe, guys. We all know that. We work in them. We know that there's a fear or perception of sometimes violence, but the truth of the matter is, when you look at it overall compared to some of the things they're dealing with in the communities after hours, schools are safe. You know, most everyone in here, I know a lot of you guys, and I know a lot of you have police officers or security or a combination of both on your campuses. So what we found is, what about when they're at home? When they're traveling, when they're shopping, when they're doing different things out in the community. You know, that's where we were really trying to, we partnered with our, it's called Klein Wells, basically the ones who do the, oh goodness, they put on weight loss competitions. We partnered with them because we're looking at the whole health of the district, not just, and this is, in my opinion, a very vital component of that is, if someone gets hurt after hours or someone gets attacked, you know, they're losing not only them, but losing their work, their time. So we brought it back in that way. And as a result, the first one we did was a situational awareness. And we had right at 100 participants on a rainy night. It wasn't really bad. And we covered some topics, you know, we played what if. The police officers in the room know exactly what I'm talking about. What if this happens, how am I gonna act? Well, it ties back to the intruderology. We're asking them to do the same thing in the classroom. So we played that. We did a lot of scenarios with that. You know, not everything's going to be a big white panel van with Chester the molester sitting in it with his big sign, you know, hey, you want some candy? That's not what you're going to see. We all know that. And so as a result, we worked through that, and then some other areas, we crime prevention through environmental design. I know some of you guys know that about, you know, how to keep shrubs back at your house when you leave. We gave them some surveys. We took them out to a survey, and it was almost comical. I took the survey, and one being the best, 99 being the worst, and I rated like an 85. I was actually horribly embarrassed at the end because some of the things that we do. Now, my neighbors know when I'm on vacation because my front porch light's on. If I get something, my wife, first thing she does is turn the front and back porch light off, and we leave for a week. Well, we don't do that normally. So those are some of the things I'm working with them, talking to them about. And then towards the end, we got into more into the improvised weapons. And a funny story, the first class we put together, we took and we put about 200 Tootsie Roll Pops, the suckers, we put them out on the chairs across the room. And we went through the whole 2-hour presentation. And at the end, Officer Deering, you know, we were getting into improvised weapons. Here in a minute, I'm gonna show you some more on improvised weapons. But he said, okay, who in the room, hold up your tootsie roll. Well, we had like 95% of holding a stick, because they'd already opened it and eaten their wedding. But the point that we made there is, we ended up passing out another round of them, is that you can hold it in such a way in your fist, and that becomes an improvised weapon. We get approached day in and day out at the schools. I've had them walk up to us in school, hey, I got my tootsie roll pop. You know, we talk about getting on an airplane. You can't travel with a firearm. Most of the police officers here, we know pretty much all your life you have a firearm on or around you. But you get on an airplane, you can. But it doesn't take a second to realize, give me a full can of Coke, I've got a weapon. You know, that's because of the density of it. Plain and simple, I've got a weapon.
So we've had multiple events with the situational awareness. And what we ended up finding is after the situational awareness, that basic defensive tactics, that same question kept coming up. Hey, we're little bitty. How are we going to fight these people off? How are we going to do this? So what we're teaching them, and it's a very hands-on practical course. You know, they're there about 3 minutes getting the safety brief, and then they're on their feet, and it's a physical course. But what we're not teaching them to be ninja warriors. You know, are we joke? We're not teaching them to be Chuck Norris. I guess he beat us all out for the award this year. That was nice. Anyhow, hey, credit our credit to you. But we're not teaching them to fight. What we're teaching them to do is get away, plain and simple. And so we're taking them to release stun runs, what we're after. And again, the improvised weapons, whether they're at an ATM and someone approaches from behind, they have a debit card in their hand. Those things are razor sharp if you strike with them right. So those are the type of things that we're working through. And I think this next slide, we're working on, y'all forgive me, as I'm giving you kind of the prototype video. We're working on a promotional video for our Street Smarts, the defensive tactics portion. I don't have any sound, that's okay. That's okay. So what you're seeing here, this is actually a group of elementary teachers, and you can see that none of them are striking the bag really hard, but you know what? When we put the red man suit, we let them go full speed against the red man, they become animals. I mean, it is crazy what they end up doing. But the beautiful part about that is it actually gives them some real world, real practical. Because let's face it, you can't go out and hit each other without, you know, one lesson is pretty well done. So with the red man suits, it's actually given us a lot of good feedback, reference to, again, being able to go full speed, giving them, I think, some of the feedback we get. I'm trying to remember, I did one of those word clouds in educator building to talk about, where the biggest word, knowledge, empowering, confidence, those are some of the things that we're hitting coming back. Let's see what, okay, we're gonna go back. So with that, what I'm gonna do, hopefully that doesn't start over. What I'm gonna do is I've got some of my instructors here. We're gonna do just a live, quick run through some of the things that we're actually teaching our class participants again. Officer Daring, Officer Haggard, and then
hey guys, everybody enjoying the meal?
Yes, sir.
Fantastic. We'll get all y'all volunteering in a little bit. We'll come up here, put some pressure points on you. It's going to be great, right? All right. What makes this program better, in my opinion, than anything else that's out there, is we don't give you a 2-hour seminar, hand you a can of mace, and say good luck. We don't teach you with some new gadget that you gotta go out and buy to figure out how it works. We teach you with things that you can take into the shower with you. Weapons that you have on you and around you every day of your life. We work off the principle of soft tissue targets. Eyes, nose, throat, ears, groin, bridge of the foot, and shin. We have three basic strikes that we use. One is the hammer fist, which is, we don't teach anybody to punch, because it's really easy to break a hand. I've been doing martial arts for over 30 years, I've seen a lot of people break their hands in fights. We teach you a hammer fist, which is this meaty portion of the hand here. We teach you how to use your elbows. We teach you how to use your knees. Right now, we're gonna demonstrate a couple of these for you. In the class, what we do is, we do a progression training, okay? One, we usually go from 1 to 4, but today, for time constraints, we go 1 to 3, okay? One being just a lineup, just a targeting, just to make sure you know where you're gonna strike. Two is gonna be about 50% of your power. And three, it's gonna be all out, 100%, okay? This is how we teach our students. Okay, hammer fist on one. Okay, two, three. Good job. All right, now we're gonna work from the elbow. We do a forward elbow, and we do a reverse elbow. Forward elbow coming forward. Okay, one, two. Job. Reverse elbow. Somebody comes up behind you. Okay? Key to this move is you want to look before you strike. This could be Uncle Joe from way back. You don't want to put your ass back in the nose and elbow, okay? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna just contact her with the bag. She's gonna look first. One, and strike. Okay? Two, strike. Three, and strike. Good. Alright, now, third thing we use are our knees. Have y'all seen how simple this is so far? Okay? This is very simple to teach. It's very simple to learn and very easy to implement in your training. Okay? RNEs, we don't want you to grab hold of your opponent, but in here when we're using the bag, just to keep her stable so she doesn't fall or get off balance, I'm gonna let her grab hold of the top of the bag, okay? And again, it's a three count, go back. Okay, 1, 2, 3! Good job, all right. Now, that's how we get everybody implemented to the techniques. That's how we teach everybody the techniques. That's not what sells this class. What sells this class, you're going to this part?
Yeah.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
One of the things that the people, when they're doing this, what he's talking about selling the class, is when we put them in fight or flight, which really happens here, it's crazy. You put them in fight or flight, they forget everything. The second you get to work with them 2 hours now, they forget it all. So we actually keep instructors standing there, hey, stop, you remember. Muscle memory, training, you got to keep doing it time and time again.
Our department has two of these suits that we use for training. We do it in our Street Smarts program. We also use these suits in our training for our officers as well. They're a great asset, well worth the money that we're spent on.
It keeps okay? Department's count to a minimum.
All right.
So if we have a minute, I'm going to tell about Cap Manders' experience with that 6'3" lady that you already was in a bar fight. You thought she'd be half to death in that suit.
All right. Now, what we do in this portion of the class, which is pretty much toward the end of the class, we've already gone over the techniques. We've shown them. We've been talking to them about the soft tissue targets. Now, this portion of the class is we also go over release, because our mantra is release, stun, and run. Again, we're not training ninjas. We're not training you to stand there and fight toward the toe with somebody. We're training you to catch them by surprise, break their hold, and get out of there as quick as possible. Okay. So we teach, when we developed this program, I went on and found out what were the most common ways a person attacks another person. How they grab them, how they hold them, what they kind of do with them, and so forth. We're going to do two of them for you today. We've already gone through them with the officer. So first one is going to be a two-hand hold. He's going to grab her by the arm with both his hands. He's going to try to drag her off someplace she doesn't want to go.
Let go!
All right. Again, you can see these suits take full contact. All right. Second one is going to be a bear hug or a grab from behind. Okay. Go.
My God, move!
All right. Good job. Now, this last portion that we cover, Chief talked about a little bit, is improvised weapons. Again, we're going to teach you things you can take in the shower with you. I can teach you how to dismantle somebody with a toothbrush. Okay? One of the things we show in the class is that.
One of the things, the release, stun, and run, we run through it constantly at the beginning. Get back. So what you're going to have is when the participant strike, when there's grab, that's the very first, the stun part of the stun is, get back! We drive that home time and time and time again, because if they're expecting you to be a victim, all of a sudden you got a crazy person on your hand and they want away from them as bad as they want.
Yes, that initial scream in their face, as loud as you can and as forceful as you can, stuns them, gives you that little window of opportunity. Again, we're not training you to be ninja warriors here, right? We're trying to get you some quick things you can do. Get out of a situation, all right? Again, that talking about improvised weapons, because we got this a lot when we did these programs for the schools. Teacher said, I don't have a knife, gun, machete, or anything like that in my classroom. How do I fight that? So we go in and we point out objects in the room that they use as a weapon. And what we use is a simple magazine. Just any magazine you have in your house, you have on your coffee table, you can find it in the doctor's office, most of you have them in the bathroom. So we show them how to use that as a weapon. This is a 1-inch by 12-inch number 2 pine board. We use these in martial arts to show strength and power. Because if we break each other's bones, nobody wants to play anymore. All right? This board is equivalent to a man's jaw or rib. So theoretically, if you break this board, you can break a man's jaw or rib. We're going to do it today with a magazine. Simple rolled up magazine. Don't roll it up like you'll smack the dog with it. There's a technique to it. Ready, officer? through heart. That's all magazine. Her hand didn't make contact. You got any bruises, knuckles, or anything like that? Simple magazine that everybody has in their home. That's why this program works. Simplicity. Anybody can use it. Everybody can learn it. It's very easy to teach as well. Thank you for your time.
All right, thank you guys. Appreciate y'all.
Thank you. Some
of the things we're actually working on that we're rolling out in the fall is we're actually going to take this, the intruderology, the street smarts, defensive tactics, and the situational awareness. We're taking it out for staff to develop, and we'll do kind of a round robin with a campus, say 60, 20 per group, and switch them around throughout the day. We've got several campuses highly interested in doing it. We feel like overall that's going to really help with the intruderology piece so that, again, they're not watching a 45-minute video and answering questions about police. We're doing some real-world practical, how to tie doors off, how to barricade, you know, how to think on your feet, put them in some situations. That's beyond that, one of the things that we're really gearing ourselves towards is our college-bound students. Now, in this politically correct world, we're gearing that towards our girls that are going to school. Plain and simple. They're out a lot of times. They're off on their own. For the first time, they find themselves in a situation. The goal here is to, and the lesson, the curriculum is almost completely done. The goal here is to get them to be aware of their surroundings and what's going on. And not to mention some of the things that are out there. Did you guys know that there's actually fingernail polish these days that can stir their drink? You can tell if it's been altered?
Coasters do.
Coasters. So we're trying to get that out to them. So and nothing else. And the college bound would actually include the child and their parent, hopefully. So that both, if nothing else, it opens the door for further communication when they leave us. Talking it through, because most of what we do is we run through it in our minds, make sure we're there. And then digital citizenship. Who in here is on Facebook? Show of hands, social media of some sort. You ever seen the one on Facebook that says, hey, do you want to tag this person? You know, you see a picture and say, do you want to tag? How are they doing that? It's facial recognition. We've got to get our kids to understand that stuff they're doing in the 6th, 7th, 8th grade through high school is going to follow. The internet's not going away. Facial recognition has become easier and cheaper and faster. And it's going to be just a handful of years. They're going to come through that front door out there looking for a job, and that camera's going to be looking at them. It's going to search the internet on its own. It's there. We're this close to it right now. So our hope is that we can get them to think a little more about what they're doing on the internet. We realize our kids and their situation, but again, we don't turn our kids loose with a car without driver's ed training. Yet we give them a cell phone, we give them a computer, we turn loose, so we're hoping we can get some training on. And of course, internet safety for parents and adults, because you've got digital natives and digital immigrants. Most of us in this room are immigrants. The kids are natives. We need to be able to, we're trying to teach them how to look at devices for hidden apps, things that are running back. Something as simple as also how to know if they're on a secure server when they're handing out their credit card information. We touch that on our situational awareness, but we really need to delve into it a little further to help them make good decisions instead of putting their debit card online for some purchase that they don't know who it is that popped up on their Facebook feed. So they're going to go there. Well, who knows where they're giving their credit card information to? And if you got to do that, how to secure a separate line of credit that's designed specifically for that so they can't wipe out your checking, savings. You know, eventually you'll get it back, but at what cost? Your mortgage behind, your lights turned off? So those are a couple things that we're working on. And then, of course, one thing that we do, and I want you guys, we take this program out to the community. Working with our school district administration, we share with them. We firmly believe that when the school day ends, our responsibility is done. You know, we work with our community, so we're taking it out. Again, we've worked with church groups, we've worked with different types of groups. One thing I'd like to offer you guys is go back to your police departments. We'll put a train-the-trainer course on for your police departments. I can't come out, obviously we can't drive to Friendswood or to Pasadena or whatever to put the class on, but we can in fact come out and do a trainer for you guys. Now we have done this, especially we've been in Magnolia, we've been League City, we've traveled some for different presentations, but again, the actual hands-on portion or the situation, we'll share whatever we have. There's no sense of people reinventing the wheels.
You're awesome. We're gonna pull up our website real quickly. I just want to make you aware of it because we really did a lot of work in getting that back up. Cherie is our person that takes care of that for us. So you want to go there and see when upcoming meetings are coming, important dates. We're keeping it current with news events that are important to you concerning security and safety. So please make your staff staff people aware of the website and access it because we've got links to bullying and other resources there concerning different hot topics dealing with security and safety. At the bottom of the agenda are some future meeting dates. Please let me know, look at your calendars when you get back. Let me know if those dates work for you. This is a quarterly meeting, very important meeting, because we get a chance to connect with you and get feedback concerning the things that you want us to do. Remember the Safe School Alerts launch, June 15th again. We'll be sending out more information. Please do the evaluation about the meeting today, also the needs assessment. And with that being said, Cherie, anything on the website? Got a minute.
I update this site at least 2, 3, 10 times a day. So all the information on this site is accurate, it's up to date. There's a lot of information on the school districts if you want to go in there. We do have the attendance options meeting on Thursday, so a lot of information we got there. A lot of information we had today will be put up on our website. There is a lot of information for parents and students to look at as well. So if you have any questions, you can go to the contact us page and all those emails get forwarded directly to me. Or under the who we are, you can contact myself, Steve, or Mr. Burley. And we do have a Facebook and Twitter that again is updated constantly for the center. But if you visit our website, the links are right here on the bottom as well.
Thank you so much for your time today. Hope it's been a good meeting for you. Thank you. Be safe.